What we do every day is allow kids to be a kid.
And our mission is to take care of all those children, traumatized children, who have been abused, who have been neglected. We have a variety of programs. One is the forensic interview program. The other one is the treatment program. Then we have a big, big one that is all the prevention efforts.
It's a big, comfortable place like Grandma's house, where kids can come and have a cookie and talk about what scares them and know that it stays here.
The forensic interview program is one of our vital programs. They interview children in a very objective, neutral manner that needs to be legally standing in court. So it's a very, very important program and is vital for the investigation of any type of child abuse and neglect in Denver.
Can I hang this on a wall?
Do you think that you'll be able to talk about your mommy and your daddy?
Yeah, it's hard.
I know it's hard.
Michael is 5 years old. He's my grandson, the only grandson that I had from my daughter who was murdered when he was 2.5 years old. And I've been raising him since.
My life was terror because I knew that someday this little boy was gonna grow up and he was gonna know that his dad killed his mom.
He didn't understand what happened to him. He didn't understand where his mom was. He didn't understand where his dad was. He didn't have the words to describe it. He was two.
He would sit in the middle of the floor and bang his head on the floor and just scream, "Why me? Why me?" Well, we didn't know why him. We didn't know why us.
When I first came here, I was kind of afraid. You know, you're going to strangers and you're entrusting them with the most precious thing in your life right now, which is the only son of your murdered daughter.
Stepping in from an adult outside world through the threshold into the center was almost like going into a fantasy land, because everything around you was for little people.
You know, what I found here is a bunch of people whose sole desire is to help a child, you know, a child who desperately needs some guidance and someone to listen to and some support. And that's what I found. You know, they took Michael and they uncovered all this pain and this hurt and this anger in layers like an onion. They just uncovered it and let him deal with it layer at a time.
So for the young kids, we use what is called play therapy or expressive therapy techniques that include art therapy, music therapy. We have started to do some yoga classes with them, relaxation techniques. What we do at the Denver Children's Advocacy Center, actually what our children allow us to do, is to walk with them through that journey from being survivors to being, you know, recovering, to really restore their childhood.
I started coming here because I was being sexually abused by my stepfather for 6 years. And like after a while, I wanted it to stop, so I told someone and here I am.
He went through the court process and ended up pleading guilty so that Autumn never had to testify. It was an excruciating process for her family.
One out of three girls are going to be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. One out of five boys are going to be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. We cannot turn away from this reality anymore.
During this time, I didn't know anything was going on until she told me, and that was very hard, very hard. That was the hardest thing.
We really need to go out and identify who are these children, where are they, where are they located, and start to do some prevention work around child sexual abuse and around child safety. And we call it Denver Safe from the start. I think that the core of this prevention program lies on the involvement of the parents and the caregivers in general and the teachers.
We made a worry box, so every time I came to see Becky, I would put my worries in the box, so I could release my worries and not feel so panicked about it. I feel more proud of myself because I'm a better person than I was that day and I'm not so scared.
When my funding ran out, I didn't have money to pay for her to continue with her therapy. They did it for free.
Our focus is the child and the recovery of the child. We don't turn any child away because of lack of financial means. The other part is that we do it in English and Spanish. So we have been able to reach to the Hispanic community, and we've been quite successful in doing that in terms of talking about the realities of child sexual abuse and protection of children to different communities.
Yeah, she's been through a lot, and she's doing great now.
She can't go back and change what's happened to her, but she can change and has changed how it will affect her from this moment on.
Know the facts. Know that this can happen to anybody. It could happen to your own kids. And once you know that and you believe that to be true, get involved. You can help us with your time. You can help us by becoming a volunteer. You can help us by giving us your skills. And also, we need money, no question about it. You know, the only way we are going to continue to grow and to be able to keep up with demand of our children is to have money.
It's not even about Michael anymore, because Michael's going to be okay. It's for the other 799 that come here that may not, that don't have somebody who steps up and says, well, you know, I will go in and stuff envelopes and do the mail out, or I will call somebody and see if they can donate money.
Michael is a normal kid now. He has friends, he has passions, he has dreams, he laughs.
Michael will never be a victim of his circumstance. This will be a circumstance that has happened in Michael's life. It will not define who he is, and it hasn't.
And when we can help them walk through that journey of hope, then what we see at the end is a child who really has recovered their childhood, who is really learning to laugh again, to have fun, to be a kid, not to be an adult.
My daughter would be proud of him. My daughter would be proud of this place. She would be so thankful. We all are.